This is an ODB Films production. Visit odbfilms.com today.
In Latin, Renovo means to renew, restore, or revive. This is the 100th show, where we explore the miraculous nature of the mundane as we look at one part of the Catholic tradition to help you engage more fully in the practice of faith. Past episodes are available at renovopodcast.com, on iTunes, on iHeartRadio. I'm Doug Tuke, and today we look at science and religion. I decided that because it's my 100th show, and I'm actually super jacked about this being my 100th show, that I would choose probably one of the hottest topics in faith formation that you can possibly imagine, which is, science isn't compatible with religion and stuff. Something that young people say a lot, which is kind of gross. Usually my response is, you should read more. But instead of being snarky, I thought, let's do a show on it. Let's really unpack it. Let's make sure that we know what the heck we're talking about. I'm all for this. I'm excited about it. Let's dig in. All right. So science and religion. Here's the thing. On one hand, there are like a lot of writings, okay, like in institutions of higher learning about ways that beautiful theology illuminates scientific ideas and how science deepens the faith, right? Theologians, philosophers, scientists, they come together and they talk, even if everyone does not agree, okay? On the other hand, the public presentation of faith and science, mostly on the internet, is pretty much like a tale of constant conflict, okay? Anyone can pose as an expert on religion or science despite being completely non-religious and never having done any serious work as a scientist, which is super frustrating. So there's a gap, okay? And people who just want to learn more about the faith and science dialogue are often kind of standing there going, where do I start, right? So catechists, teachers, parents, students, professors, writers, believers, right? If you're interested in science, a lot of times you have this question. Is there a conflict? Is there unity? And can someone please just lay out the basics? That is what we are doing today. All right. Count the following podcast as an attempt to bridge this monstrous rift between the kind of the pessimism in media and the optimism among scholars. There's good stuff in store. It might be a little bit of a longer podcast because the topic's a little bit big, but I'm loving it none the same. Okay. In fact, if you grasp this podcast, you are well on your way to understanding why Christians are needed around the table to really illuminate and guide modern science, okay? The first thing here is profess the creed, okay? Look to the creed first. If you pray, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, then your faith comes first. If you say the creed, your faith comes first. And if it doesn't, don't say the creed. So for you creed prayers, okay, Christianity is not a hypothesis or a theory. It is everything. It is a pervasive worldview, okay? As Catholics, we do not call some things intelligently designed and declare other things mere like random chances of nature, as if nature were not the handiwork of God. But we do see everything as a consistently interacting totality. Let me explain. A creation, including every last particle and force governed by the law of physics. Okay, that's a good way for us to explain it. So science cannot dictate the tenets of faith. It can't do it because that is backwards thinking. Consider the way we pray before meals. We don't examine the pizza decide whether it's a gift from God before we cross ourselves and pray, right? So in faith, we see every meal with a confident acceptance that these thy gifts come from God, period. There's no dissecting there. So know your faith and then let it guide your reasoning, okay? Dogmas are lights along the path of faith. They illuminate it and make it secure. Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraph 89. You can't navigate science in the light of faith if you do not have the lights on, so to speak, right? There are a number of sources for finding Catholic Church teaching besides the Catechism. Ludwig Ott's Fundamentals of Catholic Dogma. That's a good one. Heinrich Denzinger's Sources of Catholic Dogma. Also good. They're trusted resources for just the historical development of doctrine. You got to know it before you kind of start throwing all kinds of conflict around. So when you're sorting out all these challenging questions posted by scientific theory, just be aware of the hierarchy of truths. See the Catechism, paragraph 90. Distinguish between infallible dogmas and theological opinions that may be explored. That's a big deal. We can never accept a conclusion that the soul does not exist or that God did not create the world with a beginning in time. Most of the discussion happens where theological opinions are proposed and science can increase comprehension. Does that make sense? How do we talk about the emergence and evolution of life? How do we describe the unity of the body and the mind? How do we think about the human person compared to other creatures? Okay. Respect the experts. We are all encouraged to learn about the development of doctrine, but do not or don't play kind of armchair theologian and promote your novel opinions as some accepted teaching. You got to be careful here. You got to just get rid of speculation in that sense. That causes confusion when you're just throwing things out and you're saying it's in the name of faith and religion. That doesn't work. Instead, read the writings of theologians and communicate their work, because the modern dialogue needs good communicators, okay? So respect the scientists also. I know a lot of scientists today are not people of faith, but a lot are. And if you have not designed experiments, agonized over the data, and placed your reputation behind conclusions, it's really hard to appreciate what it takes to add new knowledge to scientific fields. So be confident in your faith and read scientific papers so you will be able to figure out what to accept or reject for yourself. Strive to become an expert and then lead others. This is a big deal. And as we get into more details here, these are all kind of foundational blocks for understanding the beauty of science and religion specifically. So don't be anxious. Don't be anxious until you find one final answer. If your thing in your pursuit of faith is, well, science can prove X, therefore faith can prove nothing, therefore why have faith? I can't find the one thing. Don't be anxious. Think of the process of navigating science in the light of faith as like a dive into some like huge mysteries, right? Faith and science are two totally different manifestations of the same reality. So when they seem to have conflicting conclusions, it's because our knowledge is not really that complete. So there are many questions that will not have clear answers, which is why they're debated. How much were Neanderthals like humans? In what way can brain chemistry influence our behavior? What do we make of quantum entanglement? Okay, there's no scientific answers for those things. So just like doctrinal understanding, it's developing. Scientific models are provisional. Okay, a provision is something that supplies a temporary commodity or a temporary ideology. Okay, scientific theories and models supply explanations until better ones are discovered with more research. So as you enter the story of ongoing research, you got to try to understand a variety of opinions. Do not articulate an opinion until you're ready. It's okay to say, I don't know. Could you explain that? Could you explain what you think when you say that? Because there's always more depth to the conversation. This is one of the beautiful things that believers can bring to science, is like, oh, this is a great conversation. Let's continue the dialogue around what you say you're proving to be truth. Now, there are facts, physics, facts of science, but I can't think of an example of where they come in conflict with what it means to be faith-filled, honestly, okay? So clarify specifically the kind of proof that science provides. And this is a little bit wordy, but it's really important. So I want to explain this. So inductive proofs widen from details to broad conclusions. They affirm. An inductive proof affirms. So scientific evidence can only provide inductive proofs of faith. For example, the Big Bang, Big Bang theory developed by a Jesuit priest. Stop saying there's conflicts. There's not a conflict here. The Big Bang affirms a beginning in time. It does not absolutely prove the ultimate T equals O or T equals zero, zero time, time beginning, right? It doesn't do that. On the contrary, deductive proofs narrow from broad statements to conclusions. That is, they confirm. All right, these are, in general, the proofs that are provided by philosophy and theology. So one may argue metaphysically, right, that past time is either finite or infinite. If it can be reasoned that infinite time is highly unlikely, then by default, finite time becomes highly likely. Confirm, affirm, inductive, deductive. Okay? I don't want to lose you. These are important terms. Okay, so don't invoke science as any kind of absolute proof of a theological conclusion. That doesn't work. The Big Bang, fine-tuning in nature, design in living things, and order in the periodic table are all inductive proofs of the opening lines of the Christian creed, okay? But only in the same way that rainbows, sunsets, and yellow lab puppies are proofs of God. Science should inspire awe and wonder, a gift of the Holy Spirit, because we see it as the study of creation. That is a beautiful gift, okay? Let's think about Mars. St. Thomas Aquinas explains in the Summa that there is an order in nature of causes and effects, okay? God creates everything and holds all things visible and invisible in existence. He's the first cause, the creator, not subject to secondary causes such as change, motion in the physical realm, okay? This is Aquinas. God's law is the, quote, supreme law. That's very much Thomas's thinking, right? If there were no other created beings with any kind of will and intellect, then the material realm would follow to the elementary unit, the laws of physics as God designed them, like on Mars. Okay, physical scientists think within the strictly physical realm, right? It is not a foreign concept, though. It's not. Just as bakers try to figure out how much oil to put in dough, chemists and physicists define isolated systems to the best of their abilities and control the variables very rigorously. Okay, is what I'm saying making sense here? Order matters. Order really matters in science, okay? In 1947, C.S. Lewis's book, Miracles, he refers to nature as, quote, hostess. So if a tomato sauce is invaded with basil, for example, nature rushes to accommodate the newcomer, right? If the sauce is stirred, heated, or spread on a crust and topped with cheese, physical laws follow suit. And these physical laws are the same throughout the universe, period. All other things being the same. All other things are not the same, which is why we cannot fly to Mars and make pizza. There's differences, okay? There's differences. So if you like, prefer not to think of nature as like a female serving up munchies. Think of matter and energy as the physical medium in which we live. This medium, nature, okay, accommodates the actions of our free will, which is why human life on this planet has rendered Earth vastly different than it would have been left to its own devices. There is differences in the way we get on to get on where we are. There simply are differences, and these are both mutually being explored through faith and theology and science. This is important to understand, okay? Let's talk about the bajillion-year-old question of humans with a body and a soul. Because this is where we run into problems, you know. Hey, it's the human body. It's all biology. There is no spirituality. There is no soul. Let's get into that, all right? Now, beyond the realm of just physical stuff is the realm of beings with wills, such as angels, humans, and possibly other animals, right? We don't know. These beings are movers also. Remember we talked about the prime mover, God? Okay, God can move particles, and if it's outside the order of nature known to us, we call it a miracle, right? Stuff that's beyond our realm, okay? Then there are angels, all right? So Thomas, again, in the Summa, talks about angels. He's referencing Pseudo-Dionysius. He says that angels are purely intellectual beings or heavenly minds. He says, intellect for angels is perfect at once, quote, from their very nature, end quote, and that they instantly know all they are created to know. The good angels choose to will good, so they always do God's will. They can move matter too, possibly in ways we do not understand. All right. And then there's us. We are body and soul. We are body and soul. So with our free will, we can move matter in limited ways. For instance, we can kick rocks. We can control anger. We can create symphonies. We can build smartphones, but we cannot turn paper into gold. We cannot flap our arms and fly. We can't live without food, or we can't ungrow our children, as much as I'd like to do that sometimes. Okay. We pursue knowledge by what Aquinas would say, discursive intellectual operation, basically by advancing from one thing to another rationally, right? As we do using the scientific method specifically, right? Hypothesis, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Actually, the scientific method is a perfect example of how body and soul unite. We take in data with our senses. We process it abstractly with our intellects. We desire to learn more. So we design experiments for further observation. Okay. That's a big deal. There's a combination here of our spiritual will and science, not just psychology and biology. There's something more Here, that's completely unexplainable by the rigorousness of science, but been philosophized upon for the last bajillion years. Okay, now be assured that physics cannot explain free will. Okay, determinism is a philosophical idea that all events are determined by strict laws of nature, that like every motion of every particle is preset by an initial state of matter. Careful with this, okay? If you scratch your arm, so the argument goes, you did it because that was the next event your matter and energy were destined to do. Weird. Okay. If there were nothing except the created physical realm, like on Mars, strict physical determinism might apply. But as Christians, we understand that the total system of reality includes both the nature and the supernature or supernatural. So while a non-believer, an atheist, is stuck with the problem of free will and how it will break the laws of physics to declare that they think they freely proclaim there is no free will, Christians basically have accepted the existence of the soul and moved on with life. We understand that free will is a spiritual power, and we use our intellects to grow in theological virtues, faith, hope, love, the cardinal virtues of prudence, justice, fortitude, temperance, so that we strive to reach our fullest potential as human persons. We want to call ourselves stewards of the planet. Okay, right? But denying free will, that makes it meaningless. Calling ourselves stewards of the planet is meaningless if we deny free will. It doesn't work. All right, fear not, evolution. Okay? In fact, go further. Catholics should never frown when people say humans evolve from atoms and primates. Ooh, now we're getting into the sensitive stuff. We should add that we evolved from the beginning. Atoms constitute the matter that makes us up, and every atom in our bodies came from the Earth, whose particles seem to have come from supernovas. Whoa, stardust. Whose matter and energy probably came from the earliest moments after the Big Bang. Wrap your noggin around that reality, okay? Did you ever wonder what path the ever-fluctuating particles of your body traversed in the last 4.5 billion years on Earth and the 13.8 billion years in the universe? Do you ever wonder how many other bodies all the uncountable particles in your body have occupied? Woo! Never mind. That can get kind of gross, okay? Now, biologically, we see like this single evolutionary step every time we see a baby. Evolution is the progression of a series of events by which living organisms accumulate changes over successive generations due to genetic inheritance and adaptive variation. I know that was wordy. Listen, every child is genetically like its parents, but also genetically unique as an individual. Also amazing. I mean, a believer might call that miraculous. Okay. As such, every child responds to his or her environment in unique ways, however slight the differences may be. So environments change over time, further affecting genetic expression. And these are facts. We're products of our environment. We're evolving as a result of our environment. But evolutionary science cannot identify a first man, first woman, or original sin committed in a moment, right? Because evolution deals with populations over thousands and millions of years. So expecting evolution to find our first parents is like expecting a bulldozer to find the first two grains of sand on a beach. It doesn't work. Not only is it the wrong tool, it's the wrong scientific concept, okay? We don't think of beaches forming one grain of sand at a time. So if Adam and Eve began to live, literally, as a fully grown man and woman through a miraculous act of God, or if they came to exist some other way, science could only shrug and keep on digging. It's not even the right process for discovering that truth. A Catholic can both explore what evolutionary science has to reveal and simultaneously believe in the reality of Adam and Eve. What a Catholic or anyone else can do is expect evolutionary science to find them any more than chemistry or physics can find the exact location of two electrons on your nose. It's not even the right tool for the job, people. Okay? Now, realize this. Science was born of Christianity. That's not a claim for bravado. It's actually meant to inspire a much bigger view. So the belief that the universe was created by God with an absolute beginning in time and a faithful order, it's basically an ancient Judeo-Christian belief forming an unbroken thread all the way back to Genesis. The Old Testament people held a belief in creation and time. The early Christians defended that belief against these pantheistic ideas of ancient Greek philosophy or even of martyrdom, right? Today, we need to be absolutely clear about the limits of science. Nothing a scientist says should shake our faith. If a scientist claims we are nothing but atoms, have no free will, or the world is eternally cycling as all the other ancient cultures did, then we simply don't agree. What we can do is hear those people out, and if only if they are amenable to a leap of faith, lead them to a fuller truth, a fuller truth. So if the biblical cultures and early Christianity are taken as the womb that nurtured and protected this fundamental belief about creation, then the Christian West can be taken as the culture that gave birth to science upon the works of scholars such as Adelard of Bath, Thierry of Chartres, Robert Grotestus, William of Auvergne, St. Albert the Great, St. Thomas Aquinas, Roger Bacon, Sigurd of Brabant, Etienne Tempier, and Father Jean Buridan, who postulated the impetus theory, right? Which was the precursor to Newtonian mechanics. We're talking about the origins of physics here. Since that time in the 11th to 14th centuries, physics has grown exponentially with new insights, understandings, capabilities, realms of observation, and measurement at unimaginable scales of minuteness and grandeur. I'm using a lot of big words here because it's a big deal. And the way that Christianity contributed to the big deal that is science, you better not ignore it. Science today, as this brawny, mature, and independent thing, that thing that it's become, it's like the prodigal son in need of its mother to call it back, right? The Holy Mother Church. We're supposed to guard truth, right? And we're supposed to guard and guide truth's children, even in the midst of nastiness, especially the nastiness of the last couple of weeks. That's what we're supposed to do. So even though we're wrought with sinning and our leadership, the fact remains true. The revelation of the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Jesus taught us the reality of the nature of God and the divinity of Christ. No other religion has ever come close to this Trinitarian or incarnational worldview. It doesn't exist anywhere else. God is one God and three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God is the second person of the Holy Trinity, the Son who became man. Christ is the Word, the Logos, the Reason, and science relies on order. Without faith in Christ, science doesn't actually make a lot of sense. It's a fact that modern science emerged in a Christian culture, and one can totally maintain, as Father Stanley L. Jackie did, that this was not happenstance. He says, there had to come a birth, the birth of the only begotten Son of the Father as man, to allow science to have its first viable birth. That's a cool line. The beginning of St. John's Gospel. It has a lot of scientific significance. Listen, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was made nothing that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness. Just stick with that if you forget everything else that I talked about. Don't forget to visit renovopodcast.com for past episodes. Please subscribe to, review, and rate our podcast. We always appreciate your input. Your topic suggestions, questions, and or comments are always welcome at doug@renovopodcast.com. Learn more about me on Twitter and Instagram at DTOOKE and the number one, or visit odbfilms.com today. Always remember to engage the tradition and live the conversion. Until next time, God bless.